Hello.
Welcome, everybody. It will be taught in English. I can say some Spanish words as well, so bienvenidos a todos. Well, I am simply here to present, to introduce you to Gilles Zoëc. He will talk about how they define the curriculum for the primary and secondary school, that it's called K-12 or K-12. For the teaching in France, okay? Gilles Zoëc is the head of research in RIA, the National Institute of Research in, no more, it's on the... Director de Investigaciones. Ah, okay, he's like professor, okay. He works at INRIA, and it's a very important position at INRIA. Okay, and he's also a professor in the École Normale Supérieure of Cachan. So I no more speak now, and gives you Gilles Zoëc.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry the talk will be in English, but my English is not too difficult to understand, especially for Latin language speakers. And I wanted to thank Fidel and Alejandro for their invitation. It's always a pleasure for me to speak about what we did in France abroad. Because when we discuss the questions of teaching and pedagogy and so on, often we are focused on our country. And it's true that our teaching systems are very different, so it's harder to communicate. And it's true also that everything we write, usually we write it in French because we want it to be read by the students or by our policymakers. So it makes it more difficult to share the documents. But nevertheless, I think that we cannot afford having building international community. First, because we should not reinvent the wheel in every country in the world. And also because we need to join our forces to convince our policymakers to do the right thing. And we are not that many in the world, and we cannot afford scattering the community too much. So today I will speak about the definition of a curriculum for K-12. So K-12 is from kindergarten to 12th grade. And I will count the grade in the easiest way. So the first year will be called first grade, and the second year second grade, and the last year 12th grade. It's not the way we count years in France. We start from 11 and we go down to zero, but nobody can understand that outside France. So so I will use the usual international terminology. Everything I will say today is written in this paper, which translates as teaching informatics from kindergarten to 12th grade. And it's a paper which has been written by the French Informatics Society, and especially its scientific committee. And you can find it in this place, and the slides, if you don't have time to write down the URL, the slides themselves are on my webpage. So if you find my webpage, you can find the slides and then the URL there. And the question is about defining a curriculum. And the first question you might ask is, why should we define a curriculum? And why should we define a curriculum today? And to tell you that, I need to tell you a little bit about the situation in France today. So first, a little bit of history, and let's start with prehistory. And in our case, prehistory is everything which is before 2012. And in fact, in these prehistory times, there has been an optional course of informatics in the 80s and in the 90s. And for some reason, in 95, it was completely stopped. And for almost two decades, from 95 to 2012, there was almost no informatics in French schools. And it started again in 1912, and with these three events. So in 1912, informatics was reintroduced as an elective course in the last year of high school and only for science students. So in the two last years of high school, the students have to take a major either in science or in literature or in economics. And it was only for the science students. And in 1915, there was an elective discovery course in 10th grade. And just in September, last September, 2 months ago, there were three major changes in the systems. First, there are notions of informatics from kindergarten and in elementary school. Then there is a course, which is a mandatory course in middle school. And there are optional courses in high school in 11th grade and 12th grade. So really, 1916 is the year where everything begins again. 2012 was just, let's say, the beginning of the process, but the main part of the process is taking place now. And also, I should say a few words about the technical school and the professional schools, which start at the level of high school. And of course, it's interesting to see that the professional schools that are often behind the general school for teaching everything are showing us the way in informatics. For instance, if you want to be a mechanic, they have understood for long that every machine now which is used in the factory is a digital machine, is digitally controlled. So they had to teach the machine as they were. And this is why informatics has started to be taught, of course, a very specific part of informatics, to students who wanted to become a technician or become a secretary. If you want to teach someone to become a secretary, you cannot use a typewriter anymore. So you have to use a text processing system, of course, because you cannot buy a typewriter on market anymore. And it's interesting to see that here they are showing us the way. Also, it's interesting to try to understand why informatics was removed from school in 95. And maybe we did a mistake at that time. And if we did a mistake, it's important to understand which one. Because if we do it again, then it's useless to fight to build a new curriculum, because informatics will disappear in a few years. So it's interesting to see what were the reasons. And it's difficult to tell which is the most important reason, because there are several. One is that informatics was mostly taught in high school by math teachers, and it's very difficult to find math teachers in France for different reasons. So they are not paid enough. Then, because of the development of informatics in industry, they found much better job in industry, so a lot of math students go to industry directly. And also, the university in France does not create enough mathematicians. They do not train enough mathematicians. Many students fail in math. The courses are very difficult, and they fail, and then we don't have enough mathematicians. So at some point, there were not enough math teachers, so the Minister of Education decided that math teachers should teach math, and there were no one to teach informatics anymore. So this is a situation which might be again the case, because as we shall see, it's also the case that informatics is taught by math teacher now, and they may change their point of view and say that geometry is more important than informatics, and they are teaching, and it's a weakness of our system now. Then we have this very enlightened analysis of the Conseil National des Programmes, so it's the National Committee for Designing Curricula, who wrote in 1991 that it's a question, say, at the economic level, are we in such a need of computer scientists that we should incentivize a large number of young people to go very early in this track? So still in the 90s, there was this idea that the digital revolution was a kind of small phenomenon that nobody should care about. Of course, here the situation is very different. It would be much more difficult today to explain that informatics does not exist. Okay, but still, it's possible, for instance, if you read the newspapers in France, some journalists and some readers of the newspaper who can comment on the papers online are very afraid that we are going to stop teaching literature because we teach informatics and literature is much more important because you cannot survive if you have not read Balzac, for instance. I don't know if you have read Balzac, but if you have not, you cannot survive. Okay. And also, okay, so here the situation is very different and it's not really a threat on us anymore. Then the last argument was that informatics has changed in the 90s, and of course it is the case. And then it came with the idea that using a computer was so simple now that you didn't need to be taught how to do it. And in fact, the first time I heard this argument was the first time I used a Macintosh. So it was in 1984, okay, so I was in high school myself, and a friend of mine showed me a Macintosh and a text processing system, and it looked very nice and so on, and he told me, you see, you don't need to program anymore, you can use it, and that's it. And of course, after the web revolution at the beginning of the 90s, it was even more obvious that you could develop websites without knowing what a while loop is. And then, even in our community, there was this idea that disruption was so important with the web and with the Macintosh and with new interfaces and so on, that the way we taught informatics, learning how to program, how to represent data and so on, was obsolete. So we gave the gun to be shot. We explained them that informatics had changed and we were dinosaurs. Okay, so and it's something which it's important that we don't do this mistake again, and it's why I think we should use the disruptive narrative very carefully. For instance, I read a paper in the news a couple of months ago, explaining that now we are not going to program computer anymore. We are going to train them, and why training them? Because you know everything about machine learning and so on. So you don't need to program a computer to recognize a picture of a dog or a cat, but you just need to train the computer. And everybody will be able to train the computer, so you don't need informatics to learn informatics anymore. And in the same paper, there was the argument that introducing informatics in high school was already obsolete because now computer learn by themselves and we don't have to explain them anything like programming. So we must be very careful with this kind of discourse. Of course, our friends who do machine learning are very eager to explain that what they do is very disruptive, but they must do that with caution. Okay, so this was to tell you that all we are going to discuss is going to disappear anyway. Okay, how, from a policy point of view, how what did change at the beginning of the year 2012? There was not a silver bullet that make everything change all of a sudden. There were many, many small events that put together created this earthquake. So first, even our policymakers understood the pervasiveness of informatics in their professional life, in their personal life, and even in the democratic life. So for instance, we have, I saw you had a change in the policy in Argentina about electronic voting, which is very good. But we didn't succeed as you did. We recently had a state surveillance law that was discussed in Senate and in the Assembly. And it's clear that they used the word algorithm almost in every sentence. But it's clear that the people who wrote this text didn't know what an algorithm was, because they explained that, for instance, an algorithm is a box. And you understand that an algorithm is an abstract object, and you cannot put an algorithm in a box. Of course, you can program, you can put a computer in a box, and you can program a computer with an algorithm, but the algorithm per se is not a box. Okay, so so we understand that to discuss these kind of problems, you need to understand a little bit what an algorithm, a program, a data is. So many people now are aware of this idea. Okay, so this was how I came to get interested in this topic. In the year 2000, I was teaching at university, and I was teaching a course on the while loop and the for loop to third year students. So they were 22, and I was teaching them the difference between a for loop and a while loop. And suddenly I understood something was going wrong there, especially because my colleagues in physics taught them about general relativity. So they had finished special relativity and they were starting general relativity. And at the same time, they were starting to understand the difference between a for loop and a while loop. And of course, it was the students have had to make choices. So they came to my office and they told me, what do you think is more interesting between cosmology and your course on programming with lists? You know, programming with lists, finding an element in a list, reversing a list, and so on. I said, of course, programming with lists is much more important than cosmology. But you see that if they had done programming with lists in kindergarten or maybe in middle school, then I could teach them things that are as interesting as cosmology, but there I couldn't. And so there was a discrepancy in the way we taught sciences in general. I went with this idea that things had to be changed for this reason. Okay, then there have been many private initiatives. So maybe you have heard about La Main à la Pâte, which is a French version of hands-on. And the goal of La Main à la Pâte is to develop science in primary school in general. Castor Informatique is the French name of the beaver. Maybe you know a little bit about the beaver, which is an online contest in informatics taken by students all over the world. So many French students got interested into that, and they were wondering why we didn't teach them that in school. And also some online, a similar online contest site prepared the students for the Olympiad of Informatics, which is another contest, and so on. And there are also off-school training programs for rich children or children with rich parents. So at some point it became a problem that something important was taught outside school, and that the student thought that school was good to teach them useless things, and off-school programs were useful to teach them useful things. So this was understood as a problem by our Minister of Education. Of course, we have the most in the world. We have the most unequal education system, but we are very keen on defending equality. So it was seen as a break in equality to education. So this was the general ideological situation in the end of the 2000 years, the year 2000. And there are a lot of tiny events. So one of them is a one-day seminar that has been organized in 2005 by Maurice Niva at the Academy of Sciences. And Maurice Niva invited me to give a talk there. And it is the first time in my life I wrote about teaching informatics in a paper that some of you have read. I was amazed that this paper is still online and still read and still used. Then the year after, 2 years after, Gérard Berry gave a course in Collège de France, which is a very high level university in our education system, where he put forward the idea that we had to develop informatics in school. There were, you remember, there used to be teaching a curriculum in informatics in the 90s. So at that time, there was a professional society of teachers, and the professional society did not disappear. So, of course, there were not that many members, but the structure itself still continued to do some lobbying, so they were not exchanging course notes anymore because there was nothing to teach anymore, but they were still doing some lobbying, and they were very clever. We had, in 2007, we had an election in France, and they wrote to every candidate to ask them what they wanted to do about teaching informatics in school. And most of the candidates answered two lines and said, thank you for your letter, it's very interesting. But one of them wrote a two-page letter explaining that he was amazed that the students in high school could not make the difference between a static and a dynamic method in Java. So I don't know who wrote this letter. But eventually he got elected, and his name was Nicolas Sarkozy. And after he became the president, this teacher organization continued lobbying and said, okay, you have written this in your letter, now it's time to go. The Academy of Sciences wrote a report in 2013, and in 2014, we wrote an open letter to the President of the Republic, and strangely enough, two former prime ministers signed this letter, so it was a kind of a small event in our small political world. So you see that if you want to make things happen, you should not just do one thing. You have to be a community, and you have to do many things at the same time, because it's the only way you can change the policy in the country. Well, I don't understand how to change the policy in the country, of course, but it's not one big event that will change things. And the policymakers are very sensitive if they hear several times the same thing coming from different places. And they are much more sensitive to this than with a very good argumentation that you could provide. It's not important that what you say is consistent or coherent or makes sense or whatever. It's important to repeat it and that it comes from many different places. Okay, a remark about the names. So it was very difficult to call this teaching informatics, and one reason was that this word would disgust the students that are not science-oriented, and especially women. So I don't know why. But this is supposed to be a feminist standpoint, that using informatics will disgust women, so we should use a different name. There is a presupposition here that women and science don't go together, which I don't think is a very feminist viewpoint, but it's presented as such. But of course, so we had to find other names. And some courses are called informatics and digital sciences. So the first thing the students ask is what the digital sciences are. And I don't know personally. For me, it's just informatics. So it means informatics and informatics, but it's much better. And another name is informatics and digital creation. So of course, when you write a program, you create something. So it's digital creation, but I don't see, again, the difference between digital creation, digital science, and informatics. And here we have a presupposition that we have to fight from the beginning. It is that even in high school, you have students that are made for science and students that are not made for science. And it's even made explicit by a few politicians. So you know that we again have a presidential election this year. So François Béroux, who is a candidate, explained that the main problem of school is not informatics, it is reading. And so there is no problem with teaching informatics, according to him. And another former candidate, but fortunately he was beaten at the primary of his party, wanted to remove all sciences from high school. So all sciences would have became optional courses. And the three courses he wanted to keep as mandatory were French, English, and history. And you have to know that he was a history teacher before. And you see that this idea that science is not that important, and maybe we need some engineers. Eventually we need some engineers, so we have to teach science. Okay, we cannot avoid it. But for the citizen, it's not useful to understand science. It's an idea which is very present in France. I think it's a little bit less present in Argentina, so you're very lucky in this respect. But we have to fight for the values of science again and again in France. And if you are not in this situation, you're very lucky, because it's very boring to do that and to explain that knowing how to count, and it's important to know what the Newton's law is, and it's important to know how you can encrypt and decrypt a message with César's algorithms, and so on. So if you don't understand this, you cannot be a free citizen. And basically, we have to explain that to people who don't know what Newton's law is, what César's algorithm is, and they don't have the feeling that they are not free. So it's very difficult. Okay, so to conclude with this situation in the French system now, as you know, to teach something we need four ingredients. We need students, of course, we need teachers, we need a curriculum, and we need time. So we have two of them. We have students. So even when the courses are optional or elective, we see that many students come to our courses. When it's mandatory, of course, they come. And we have a good curricula. So now the curricula in France are decided by a national committee, which is called the Conseil Supérieur des Programmes, and which was called before the Conseil National des Programmes, but it's almost the same committee. And this committee did a good job. Okay, if you read the curriculum, you can discuss whether the while loop should be taught in seventh grade or in eighth grade. Okay, there is room for discussion, but if you take it from a global perspective, they did a good job, and we now have a curriculum. Okay, what we don't have is teachers. So in primary school, of course, you have only one teacher in the class, and the teacher is just teaching everything. So the solution to have good teaching of informatics in primary school is first to train teachers from the beginning and teach them informatics so that they can teach it to the pupils. And we don't do that. So they don't have courses in informatics in their curriculum for being a teacher. But what we do have is a constant learning program, which is rather good. It's called Class Code. And for the teachers who take this course online, they can really learn things and then teach them. And it's good, but it's a very difficult task, because we have 300,000 primary school teachers. So even if you organize a MOOC, and even if you organize constant lifelong training for them, it's very difficult to reach all of them. For instance, it was for middle school teachers. I organized a 1 week school last summer. Okay, but I had 70 teachers. Okay, 70 teachers is nothing from a statistical point of view. Okay, but we have to start from somewhere. In middle school, the informatics is taught by the math teacher and the technology teachers. So we have math and technology, which are already two subjects. So informatics is not a new subject, but it's taught by math teacher within the math course, and by technology teachers within the technology course. Of course, none of them did have a training in informatics when they were students, so they had to learn what they have to teach. So this is why we organized this kind of a summer school for them. And we have just the beginning of the idea that we should recruit informatics teachers in middle school and in high school. And in France, we recruit the professors with a competitive exam. And for the first year, next year, the competitive exam in math will include math with a specialty in math and math with a specialty in informatics. So they might be math and informatics teachers. Maybe 10 of them will be hired. Okay, but it's a beginning. And then time, we don't have time either. So I told you for middle school, it is inside the math course and inside the technology course. So there is no room for informatics in the schedule of the students. In high school, it's almost the same thing. The teachers, maybe any teacher who decides to teach it. So most of them are math teachers, some of them are physics teacher and music teacher, why not, but most of them are math teacher. And the time does exist, but it's optional or elective. So there is no mandatory course for the students there. Okay, so why isn't it a subject per se? Why don't we have dedicated time in the students' schedule so far? And we have seen that there are three groups that are fighting against the idea of teaching informatics in school. So it's useful to know your enemies. So here are the enemies we have in France. The first one is the teachers of other sciences, for instance, the math teachers. Okay, so once I gave a talk like this one to math teachers, and in the end, there was a math teacher who told me, so if there is 1 minute more for informatics, there will be 1 minute less for math. So for this reason, I think we should not teach informatics in school. It's much important to know geometry, algebra, and so on. So my question was, why do you think the minute we take for informatics should be taken to math, and not why not to geography or sports or... Okay, where does this assumption come from? And he told me because each time we have to find a scapegoat, it's math. I said, okay, maybe the problem comes from you then, rather than from us, because if every problem in the world comes to you, then you have to work to understand why. Okay, but you see that here you have people who are very against this idea, and what I try to convince them of is that if we teach informatics, the students might understand better why math are useful. Okay, for instance, once I was I had a teacher who told me, well, it's not completely a true story, but okay, it's a story. A teacher told me my students prefer to play with video games than learning Cartesian coordinates. Okay, so but why don't you tell them that video games are built using coordinates? I mean, if you want to have a 3D representation of space in a perspective, okay, you know that you have to represent the point X, Y, Z by the point X over Z, Y over Z. Okay. So you can motivate your use of coordinates by video games. And this kind of idea is not very familiar to math teachers. Of course, some math teachers do use this kind of motivations, but if the students have to build their own video game, then they will understand the use of Cartesian coordinates, and then they will be more interested in math. But this is not what math teachers think in general. Of course, they don't think the same thing, all of them. Some are more open to informatics, some are very hostile, but in general, hostility is there. Then you have another group, which is those who fight against science and technology in general. So I told you that for some people, and especially in Europe and especially in France, if you learn literature, humanities, and so on, it's enough. And we have seen that even politicians, some politicians think this way. So these people, of course, they don't want to teach informatics because they don't want to teach any science. And it's interesting that these two groups are kind of objective allies. Of course, they don't share the same values, but they share the same goal. So of course, here we have to explain that science is a route of progress to a brighter future. And okay, not all of them believe this, but sometimes it's very subtle. For instance, why do we send the student to school? Okay, maybe for them to get some knowledge. Okay. This is one reason. But our current president of Republic has a different opinion. For instance, he defines school as what makes the Republic together, what the Republic is built on. So in fact, what is important is that the students go to school and meet other students, and together they form a community. Whether they learn something or not seems to be a kind of secondary goal. Okay, then if you think that the goal of the school is to make us better citizens, to understand the values of Republic and to understand human rights and so on, then you see that you have to teach history and you have to teach ethics and you have to teach morals and there is not much room for science. And this view on school is shared by many people in my country, unfortunately. Especially because it's filmed. I don't claim that human rights are useless. I mean, I love human rights, but all your teaching cannot be just about teaching how to be good. You have to teach knowledge at some point. And it's also what human rights say, in a way. Okay, then we have a third group, which is maybe much more dangerous than the other ones, is all those who believe they know what informatics is. And we have some of these people in schools. For instance, when I was giving a course for training high school teachers to teach informatics, and there was an art professor there. So I was very happy because most of my professors were math professors and some of them were physics professors, but there was an art teacher. So I was very happy that art teachers got interested in informatics, but it didn't went very well because after 2 weeks, she told me that we have not yet started informatics. So, okay, why not? She said, because to start informatics, you have to click on this icon, and said, which icon? And in fact, it was a Photoshop icon. So for her, informatics means using Photoshop. I love Photoshop, and I think it's very good that art teachers teach Photoshop to their students, but it's not informatics, it's art. And it's very good, I like art very much, but there was a complete misconception of what informatics was. And this misconception is developed with a myth. So it's based on a myth, and this myth is called the digital natives. So many times you come to see a policymaker, and they start by explaining you that they are grandson or granddaughter. She's expert in informatics. Okay, she's two, but she's expert in informatics, and she could teach us everything. Okay, very good. I'm eager to meet her. But then they understand that because you can use Photoshop or maybe send a mail or maybe watch a video online, use YouTube, then you're a computer scientist. And these people, they are much more dangerous than the math teachers and those who fight science. At least we know what the other want. These ones, we are completely lost. We don't speak the same language. Okay, so this was for my long introduction. So don't worry, I know time passes. The introduction was very long. Now, what about building a coherent curriculum? And here the keyword is coherent. So what is the problem? So if you count kindergarten, then you have 12th grade. So all together, this is 15 years that the pupils start at 3 and they end at 18. And in this, we have to imagine what they need to learn at each level. And a 15-level structure where you have at the same time students, pupils who are 3 and pupils who are 18, it's kind of difficult to have a global view on it. First, because the pupils change a lot between 3 and 18, where we hope they change a little bit, at least. And also, a 15-level structure is something complex. Okay, and there could be a disaster, which is to teach the for loop in kindergarten, to teach the for loop in primary school, and to teach the for loop in middle school, and to teach the for loop in high school. And it seems to be a kind of a theoretical threat, but it's not. For instance, at some point, the continental drift was very popular in science. Okay, so we understood why the continents were moving, and we were very happy of that. And both the geography teachers and the earth science teachers, the earth science teachers are the biology teachers, but they have to teach earth science as well, were very eager to teach continental drift. But both in middle school and in high school, so in a full cursus, in a full curriculum, from kindergarten to high school, the students had to learn continental drift 6 times. Okay, 3 times in geography and 3 times in earth sciences. So they were very upset with that, and they were bored with this idea. And this may happen if we don't have a global view on what we are teaching. And even I have to claim I'm guilty as well. For instance, in my school, you can learn the termination of simply typed lambda calculus 3 times, because there is an optional course at the undergrad level. Okay, so then if you take this logic for computer science at elementary level as an undergrad student, you already learn how to do the termination of lambda calculus. But then, as a first year master student, it's mandatory to learn it. Okay, and not all students have taken the optional course before, so you have to do it again. And then in second years of masters, we do it again because we have a few students who come from different schools where they don't teach well, so they don't know how to prove the termination of lambda calculus, so we have to do it again. And the students complain, and of course they complain, and they are entitled to complain. So we see that even in a very simple structure of a 5-year university curriculum, we have many repetitions. I just took this example because I teach it every year, but there are many other examples, of course. So this is a problem that has been identified with our national committee, our higher committee for curricula. And it's also a problem that we have been working at the French Informatics Society, especially because the higher committee for curricula asked us to give them guidelines, not to define the curriculum in their place, but to give them a general guideline for building a curriculum, this coherent curriculum. And the paper I showed you at the beginning is the answer we wrote for them. And here are the cooking recipe we gave them to build a curriculum. Okay, so we had to put things in a kind of abstract way. Especially because the document had to be short, and so we built our algorithm on 3 principles. And the idea is that we have, when we teach informatics, three equilibria to take into account. And if we design a curriculum which respects these three equilibria, then we have done a good job, and otherwise we have to change it a little bit. Okay, so the first equilibrium is between the concept of informatics, and we have developed in the French Informatics Society the idea that there are 4 concepts in informatics: algorithm, machine, language, and information. Then informatics is different from other sciences and other technologies by the fact that it is both a science and a technology. So we have to teach both informatics as a scientific topic and as a technological topic, and we have to keep a balance between this and that. And finally, and maybe it's the most difficult equilibrium, it's we have to find the good equilibrium between the core of the subject, informatics, and its interaction with other sciences, with other technologies, and with society. And okay, so let me describe each of them. Okay, so if you ask the question, what is physics, what is mathematics, or what is whatever, you have usually two ways to understand, to answer this question. One is to explain what are the object that this science studies. So for instance, for biology, the answer is easy, it's life. Okay, it's just in one word. But then you can also focus on the method which is used to study life. And for biology, for instance, it's the experimental method. You have theories and experiments, and they have to agree in some way, and so on. Okay. It's possible to give a method-based definition of informatics, but it's kind of difficult. And what is much easier is to define informatics by the object it studies. And if we try to list these objects, we come to this idea that we have only four types of objects, which is already a lot. You remember biology has one, life, okay? But we have four languages, information, machines, and algorithms. And there is a kind of originality of informatics that you cannot define it with a single concept. So if you say informatics is a science of algorithms, it's wrong. If you say it's a science of machine, it's wrong. So we are not like biologists. We are not. We are not the specialists of a science that is built around one concept. And maybe the sciences in the future will be like us. So more and more we have interdisciplinary work that join several concepts. And the idea that physics is studying matter and biology is studying life and social sciences are studying societies. Okay, maybe these are the sciences of the 20th century and the sciences of the 21st century. They will be much more entangled concepts. Okay, so these concepts have a kind of structure, and we can define informatics as the fact of making machine execute algorithms. And in particular, if you take the scribes of Mesopotamia, they knew many algorithms, but they were not computer scientists, okay, because they used the algorithm themselves. And if you take the engineers of the antiquity or the Middle Ages, they built machines, but their machines were not there to execute algorithms, so they were not computer scientists either. And it's only in the middle of the 20th century, somewhere between 1941 and 1947, that we started building machines that can execute algorithms. Okay, it's not exactly right, because for instance, in the 17th century, we had machines to do addition and multiplication, but these machines were not universal. So we cannot say they were able to execute all algorithms, all symbolic algorithms. So there were not computers for this reason. Okay, so this explains why we have the concept of algorithm and the concept of machine in informatics, because it's when these two concepts joined to build a new science that informatics started. Okay, but then it's not enough, because if you want to have a machine that executes an algorithm, then you have to express this algorithm in a language. Okay, so this is how the concept of language comes, and you have your algorithm will process something, and this thing is called information. Okay, so this is how we came to this to these four concepts. Of course, each of these concepts is very old. For instance, algorithms and machine, we know they were both in antiquity. But to take the concept of language, in the 13th century, the musicians invented the musical notation as we know it today. And in the 19th century, on boats, the sailors invented languages with flags and so on. I don't know much about these languages. I know a little bit better the musical language. So you see that the notion of formal language, I'm not interested here in natural languages. I'm speaking of formal languages. The notion of formal language is quite old. But in the 13th century, they invented one language, or maybe 10, I don't know. But we invent hundreds of languages every day, and this makes a difference. So we should not teach the students the Java or the musical notation. We should teach them eventually how to build their own language. And here, of course, I spoke a lot about programming languages, and but there are other languages. For instance, HTML is a formal language, but it's not Turing complete. Okay, information, of course, it's a very old concept as well. And even the representation of information has a very long history, which starts with writing and then alphabet and then printing press and so on. And also it's very interesting to see which concept is more the most important for you. So here is a test you can do. You ask your students or your policymaker, who is the greatest ancestor of informatics? Okay, Alcuevar is me. You know who you're talking to. Pascal, the Pascal machine that did addition. So here you see the machine which is put forward. Language, it's much more difficult to find, but all this idea that we live in a world of signs and okay, so maybe you can cite Peirce or Saussure. So these people for whom informatics comes from this idea of sign and semiology and so on, they think language is the most important. For instance, Frege also could be cited as the one who designed the first formal language for mathematics. And of course, if you get Gutenberg, for instance, you know that it's someone who sees informatics as a science of information. What is important here is that if you take this definition of informatics, I can bet that in 100 years it will still work. And it did work 50 years ago. And 50 years ago, we had different algorithms, different machines, different languages, different informations, but the pieces of information, but we had languages, machine information. So it's a good way to teach stable notions. So we can teach the blockchain if you like, but you know that in 50 years, the blockchain will have disappeared and there will be something else. But if you teach what an algorithm is, what a machine is, what a language is, and what information is, then you know that you're giving to your students a concept they will be using for their life. And we have to think that our students now, they will still be on job market in 2080. Okay, so we have to teach them something which will be useful to them in 2080. So it's difficult to anticipate, and it's why it's good to focus, especially for the younger students, on a basic concept. Okay, so these are examples of topics you can associate to each concept. And here, our community, our computer science community, is still not very mature. Because if you take physicists, for instance, they always fight each other and much more strongly and much more violently than we do. But when it comes to teach physics in school, they are all united. And there is no one who says we should only teach special relativity, or we should only teach waves, or we should only teach mechanics, or we should only take electricity. When it comes to define a curriculum, they find an agreement. And this is something we have not yet reached. For instance, take robotics. There are machines that are called robots. These machines process information. They have sensors and actuators and so on. They implement very original algorithms, feedback, and so on. They lead to very interesting programming languages, reactive programming languages. So it's completely part of informatics. But still, my friends who teach robotics, they believe they teach something different. So they believe robotics is not part of informatics. It's a different science because it has a link with mechanics. And it is the same for numerical analysis, for instance. My friends who teach numerical analysis, they are mathematicians. Of course, they use computers, they build algorithms, they design programs, but they are mathematicians. They don't want to be called informaticians. So this is why, for instance, sometimes the word numerical sciences is used, but We shouldn't. We should just use informatics and convince them that what they are doing is informatics, and it's not bad. I mean, it's not something they should be ashamed of. Everyone can do informatics, and they can maybe even be proud of it, but who knows. Okay, this thinking of this equilibrium, you may think it's completely obvious, and anyone who would design a curriculum for informatics would think this way, but it's not exactly the case. For instance, take a math teacher and ask her what she wants to teach, or ask him what he wants to teach. Mostly, for them, informatics is a science of algorithms. Okay, so even if they do their best to teach informatics, it will be always focused on algorithms. And even worse, sometimes it's only algorithms that apply to mathematical objects. So once I was giving a talk to math teachers again, and another teacher told me that informatics is a science of algorithms, right? I said, okay, I don't agree with that, but okay, let's assume I do. He said, algorithms, we have had algorithms in math for 2,500 years. I said, okay, we have had algorithms for 5,000 years, but let's assume you're right. And he said, okay, so we teach algorithms in math. I said, okay, that's correct. So we don't need to teach informatics. Then I asked, but which algorithm are you teaching? So he was teaching Euclid's algorithm and the Eratosthenes sieve. And this was the two algorithms he knew. And then I said, okay, let's focus on algorithms. What about routing algorithms? And in fact, routing algorithms is completely out of the scope of mathematics. Of course, not quite, because you have a lot of probability theory there and so on. But the idea, the basic ideas of routing algorithms, they are not talking about numbers, prime numbers, relatively prime numbers, and so on. So the math teachers are not interested in that. But routing algorithms are much more used than Euclid's algorithm every day. I mean, each time you send a mail, there is a routing algorithm. Each time you use a browser, you use a routing algorithm. I use Euclid's algorithm basically when I teach it. Okay, maybe from time to time I used Euclid's algorithm for other means, for reasons. But Euclid's algorithm is not an important algorithm in computer science, while routing algorithms are. So you see that math teachers have a very biased view on what informatics is. But they are not the only ones. You remember, we have math teachers and technology teachers who teach informatics. What do you think informatics is for technology teachers? It's the science of machines. A particular kind of machines that are computers. But basically, they don't care about languages, algorithms, information. For them, the central idea is a machine. And I even met one day, only once in my life, someone for whom informatics was the science of languages. And he was a colleague who had built a curriculum for informatics in the 60s or 70s. So we can understand the misconception they had at that time. That was based on programming languages and natural languages. And there was nothing about algorithms, machines, information, and so on. It was languages and languages. And of course, it was a very biased view of informatics. And we could not accept that in other subjects in high school, we taught, for instance, history from the 18th century to the 19th century period. Okay, we understand that if we teach history, we have to teach a little bit of history, ancient history, Middle Ages, a little bit of modern history, and so on. If you teach only modern history, it doesn't make sense. Okay. And it is the same for informatics, and it's very difficult because we all have a biased view of informatics, and we have to fight against this natural tendency. Okay, so when we gave our guidelines to the higher committee for curricula, we tried for each of these concepts to draw a progression from primary school, middle school, and high school. Okay, so for instance, if you take the concept of algorithm, and we did that for the four concepts, what you can do in primary school is to understand that there are some methods that you know that are systematic. For instance, you want to compute the plural of a word. Okay, you have an algorithm. You have to check the last letter of the word and add an S or maybe not, and so on. Okay, but then you can understand that cooking recipes are algorithms. You can understand that when you weight an object with a Robert-Laval balance, you use dichotomy, you use a method to find the right amount of masses you put on one side of the balance. And it, you can even understand, but it's already kind of abstract, that you use the same algorithm when you look for a word in the dictionary. So all this using a Robert-Laval balance, dictionary, plural, are things the pupils already learn. And it's only, the idea here is only to make them understand that what it's a method which is systematic and they can formulate. And that's it for primary school. Okay, middle school, of course, you can be much more ambitious, and you can teach basic algorithms and, I don't know, searching and sorting, maybe more searching than sorting, or maybe the easiest sorting algorithms. You can teach the basic principles for building algorithms, like generate and test, binary decomposition, and so on. And of course, in high school, you can be even more ambitious. You can learn classical algorithms and text images and so on. You can start learning the complexity of an algorithm. So of course, we don't claim that insertion sort should be taught in that grade or that grade. So this has to be discussed at a different level. But here we have a kind of progression of what the students should know about algorithms, and we can do the same thing for languages. For the concept of language, for the concept of information, and the concept of machine. Okay, let's move to the second equilibrium, which is between science and technology. And again, it is something which is kind of original of informatics, which is that it is at the same time a science and a technology. So at the same time, it answers questions like, is there a sorting algorithm in linear time? Okay, and the answer is no. And it's also an activity where we build objects that have a purpose, and this makes it a technology. For instance, you can build a binary search program. And the fact that the program you build is immaterial does not change the fact that it's a technology. You build something. Okay, so the students should both learn that binary search is logarithmic and build their own binary search program. So they have to learn knowledge and to build objects, and they have to do both. So when I worked on this presentation, I thought that there was a great originality of informatics here, that it is both a science and a technology. And for instance, if you take thermodynamics, it's very different from building steam engines. So you have engineers who can build steam engines, and you have physicists who can formulate the second principle of thermodynamics. In fact, I looked at the history of the second principle of thermodynamics, and it has been published for the first time in a paper by Carnot, Sadi Carnot. And in fact, the title of the paper is How to Build a Steam Engine. So it's not completely clear that in the 19th century, science and technology were not much more intricate than they are now. And finally, maybe informatics is not that original. It is, in the past, we have had a lot of interaction between science and technology. In the future, we will. And it's only a myth that we present to students that there is a beautiful abstract thermodynamics which has nothing to do with the steam engine. And when you look at history, people were interested in designing steam engines, and this is why they studied thermodynamics. So maybe when I say it's original, I should be much more careful than that. But in any case, the students have to do both, and this is why we have to teach them things on the blackboard. But like playing an instrument, you can only learn. You cannot learn to play an instrument just by watching someone talking at the blackboard. You have to do it yourself. And this is why in informatics, projects are very important. So there is room for discussion. Some of my colleagues think that you can do a 100 project-oriented teaching. I am more keen on an organization of time where project is only 90% of your time. And you leave room for 10% for lectures. Some of my colleagues think it should be half and half. Okay. But We all agree that writing programs, designing objects is important when you learn informatics. If you don't do it, you don't understand what you're talking about. Okay, and again, you have viewpoints to be fought here. For instance, several of us, and I have to I came from a community where this is a very common point, that informatics is a science and it has nothing to do with technology. For instance, many of my colleagues, if their grandmother has a problem with Windows or whatever, they don't want to fix it. Now, they don't know how to fix it, okay? So it's not their job. Okay. Myself, I try. Usually I fail, but at least I try. And I think it's if I fail, it's my failure. Okay? It's not because I'm too clever to understand Windows. And in fact, this is a very old attitude. For instance, you have a lot of physicists who cannot change a wheel. Okay, they understand, they can speak about the motion of a wheel and so on. They can write an equation about the motion of the wheel, but if they have a flat wheel, they cannot change it. Okay. So it's an attitude in life in general. And we have even a saying in informatics that informatics has not more to do with computers than astronomy with telescopes. And it's a very bad idea. I think informatics has something to do with computers. It's not only the science of computers, but you cannot remove informatics for computers because then the scribes in Mesopotamia would be computer scientists and we are different from them in many respects. Okay, then you have also the other viewpoint that it's only a technology and you have nothing to learn, just do it and that's enough. And for instance, we have a school in France who took this attitude. It's a kind of university. So it has been built by an engineer who is the boss of a company that is an internet provider. In fact, it's my own internet provider at home, so I like this company very much. I shouldn't say too many nasty words against them because maybe they will cut my connection. But this guy created a school which is called 42. And in this school 42, they don't have teachers. Okay, the students go there, do, and learn by themselves, and they look online if they don't know how to do it. They only have teachers to grade the exams, to grade the projects. Okay. Well, I don't think it's a good idea. I think we do need teachers, and it's too extreme in this direction, which is a good direction, but when you go too extremely in a good direction, it's a bad idea. So you see that here again, it's very difficult to find your way between those who tell you that there is nothing to learn, you don't need teachers, and those who tell you that it's a science that has nothing to do with telescopes. It's very difficult to find a middle way between these two extremes. Okay, then we can go to the third equilibrium, which is between the core of the subject and its interaction. And in fact, the success of informatics is our enemy here. Because the success of informatics makes informatics be everywhere. Okay, informatics is in every activity you do, you use informatics. You want to talk, you use a chat program, you want to cook, you find your cookie recipe online. Okay, name it, you find it. Okay, but it doesn't mean that everything is informatics. Okay, cooking is not informatics. Learning how to cook is not learning informatics, even if to learn how to cook you have to use a browser and a search engine to find your cooking recipe, it's not learning informatics. And I already told you about the Photoshop anecdote. Another one is a pH meter anecdote. So for instance, a chemist professor once told me, well, I teach informatics, I use a digital pH meter. Okay, so it's very good. I love a digital pH meter. I was very bad at computing the pH of a solution with these colored indicators that never worked. So I'm sure digital pH meters make chemistry teaching much better, much more interesting, and so on, but it has nothing to do with teaching informatics. It's not because you have a digital object that it is teaching informatics. So if we didn't have pH meters, if we didn't have Photoshop, the task would be much easier for us. It would be much more difficult to convince that it is important to learn informatics, but then we would not have these traps here. Okay, so this again, ideas that we need to fight. The first one is that informatics is a part of math. Of course, informatics has strong links with math, but it's not a part of math. And now it's taught as a part of math. So it's not a part of technology, and it's also taught as a part of technology. It's not a part of physics. So for instance, David Deutsch defines informatics as a part of physics because it's a physical law that determines what can be computed or not, which is true, but it doesn't make informatics part of physics. Okay, it's not a part of linguistics. I already told you about this guy who built this curriculum only centered on computational linguistics and formal language processing. Okay, now it's very popular to think that it's part of media studies. Okay, so we have teachers in France who teach media studies. So it's very interesting. We don't have teachers who teach informatics, but we have teachers who teach media studies. Most of the time, they are in charge of the library of the school. And the librarian in France are themselves teachers. So they teach how to use a library, but also how to process information in general. Which is very useful, of course, how to be careful what you read online. So this is part of what they teach. But then it doesn't make them informatics teachers. So it's important that at the same time, we acknowledge the fact that informatics has a lot of interactions with many other subjects. And it's a very good opportunity to have interdisciplinary projects. But informatics should not be diluted in other subjects. And you remember I told you that between 1995 and 2012, there were no informatics in school. And in fact, it's not completely the case. There were objectives in informatics, but the idea that was as informatics is everywhere, all the teachers should contribute to teaching informatics. So we built at the French Informatics Society a metaphor to explain that. French is, of course, everywhere, or for you, Spanish. Okay, where when you do math, you have to reach the exercise in French. When you write a dissertation in history, you have to write it in French. And when you, even when you learn Spanish, you have to translate text from French to Spanish. So French is everywhere. So for this reason, we should suppress French teachers, and all the teachers will teach French. Okay, so it's enough. And you can say the same thing for math. For instance, in geography, they have to learn what latitude and longitude is. So why don't we let the geography teacher explain what a coordinate system is? And they have, in history, they have to teach what is before BC and AC. So it's a good time to teach the students what negative numbers is. So you see that we don't really need math teachers. History teachers and geography teachers can do the job. And of course, this is the idea of dilution that made us lose 20 years. Because the idea that a little bit of informatics in math about algorithms and numbers and a little bit of informatics in technology about the computer architecture or maybe networks and a little bit of informatics in history, I don't know what. No, of course, in history, informatics is very important, has been very important in the resolution of the Second World War, as you know. So let the history teacher teach cryptography. It's part of history. Okay. So it doesn't work, and we know it by facts. It's not an ideologic standpoint that it doesn't work, it's just that we have tried and it didn't work. So it's much stronger than ideology. Okay. So here we spoke about the interaction between informatics and other subjects. And there is another topic which is relating to informatics and interaction to different things, which is the interaction with society questions. And of course, we don't think that informatics society questions should be avoided, and they should be part of the teaching of informatics. And in fact, I even claim that whatever you teach, the ethic of what you teach is important. For instance, you cannot teach biology Well, I don't teach biology, so the biology teachers can do what they do, what they want. But if I had to teach biology, I would include a part of ethics in my teaching. You cannot avoid these kind of questions. Okay, and for instance, our students should be more aware of the good use and the bad use of social media. They should understand what privacy is, and they should understand how to respect the privacy or their schoolmates, mostly, and other people, and so on. First, our teaching should not be limited to that, to this. And you have a lot of people in France who think informatics is a threat, and what school has to do is to protect our children against this threat, against terrorism online, and so on. Okay, so it's a very scary view of informatics. But also, they know the method to teach the students how to protect themselves against ideologies, terrorism, and so on. And what they do is they give rules to the students. So say, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that, you shouldn't talk to anyone online, and so on. And the students mostly don't care. Okay, so the way we think this issues should be addressed is more by giving the students the scientific and the technological knowledge they need to understand how to behave. So for instance, if you tell them that information travels at the speed of light, okay, so it takes 100 milliseconds to go from for a bit of information to go from here to Russia, or what is just here? China, okay, to go from here to China. For us, we use Australia, but of course Australia is very near here, so it's much faster, okay, whatever. So information travels at the speed of light. It can be duplicated at a cost which is zero. Okay, so if you want to Xerox a photo, it costs 100 pesos. If you want to duplicate a file, it costs zero. Okay, and then when you put it online, it's duplicated everywhere, so it's there for an infinite time. You cannot remove the information that you put online. You can try, but probably a copy will remain, and you don't know how long. Okay, if you have understood these three things, then by yourself, you can understand that what you put online matters, that you should be careful with what you put online. You cannot put a photo of yourself or of someone else and thinking nobody will see it or nobody will see it in the future. You know that it will travel at the velocity of light, so in half a second everyone will be, and in a tenth of a second everyone will be able to see it on Earth. It will be duplicated many times because this is zero cost, and you cannot remove it. So by yourself, you can understand how to protect your privacy and how to protect the privacy of others. This is a question we should discuss with the students, but our discussion should be based on our scientific and technological teaching. Otherwise, it's completely meaningless for the students. Imagine there is an object that is called the web and you have never heard about, and you have a teacher who tells you, be careful with the web. Okay, what does it mean for you? Nothing. Okay, to conclude, a little bit about the organization in time. So I told you that we have to organize a curriculum in 15 years, and I gave you an example with the concept of algorithm, of a progression that we can design in three steps. And more generally, there is one important question, which is, when do you learn how to program? And do we need to learn how to program, and why? And then there is a little thought experiment here. Imagine you have to teach RSA to your students. Okay, so you explain what a public key is, what a private key is. You prove, you give a proof of Fermat, little theorem, and blah, blah, blah. Okay, so you know how to teach RSA. Okay, then you have two possible conclusions to your course. Either the students know how to write a small program, and you tell them, okay, now let's program RSA and let's exchange messages and see how they are encrypted and how they are decrypted. Okay, but if you have students who do not know how to program, your conclusion will be that some computer scientists use Fermat's little theorem to encrypt and decrypt messages. But the students will be kept out of this process. They will be able to watch what is going on, but they are not going to be able to do something. Okay? So this is why it's important to learn how to write a program yourself, because you go from a position where you're completely in a passive situation to a position where you're in an active situation and you can do something yourself. Okay, so this is why learning how to program, or now we use the word to code for some reason, I don't know, it's very fashionable now, at least in French. There are coding goûté, which means have afternoon teas about coding, okay? Coding goûté. Okay, so it's much more fashionable than programming goûté. Nobody would go to a programming goûté, but a coding goûté, coding afternoon tea is good. Okay, but it's important to learn how to write a program or to code if you like, and it's a key step in learning computer science, in learning informatics. And this is why we organized the general schedule in three steps. In the second step, you learn how to program, and before you have everything you can do before you learn how to program, and after you have everything you can do after you have learned how to program. Okay? So these three steps map very well with the organization of school, where we have three schools, elementary school, middle school, high school, and middle school seems to be the right time to learn how to program. First, even if you can understand or play with programs when you are in elementary school, it seems that to really understand what a programming language is, it's difficult in elementary school. But if you look at what the students learn in middle school, so middle school is the beginning of what you call high school. It is between 11 and 15. And first, we know that it is the age where their brain develops the capacity of abstraction. And it seems to be a purely biological process. So I don't want to go in this discussion whether it's a cultural or biological process, but whether cultural or biological, the students can learn abstract things in middle school. And if you see what they learn in other topics, they move from a very concrete approach to questions to a more abstract one. For instance, they learn what a variable is in mathematics, and to understand what a variable is, or what a function is, you need this kind of abstraction level, which is comparable to what you need to learn to program. Of course, you can program very concrete things, like taking a cat and moving the cat from 10 pixels, okay? But then if you want to have a general function that moves the cat from a number of pixels, which is n, okay, it's more difficult, and you need an abstraction level that elementary students, pupils, do not have. Okay, maybe in the last year of elementary school they can start, but it's more the kind of thing you learn in middle school. So it means that we have an organization of time, which is that before they learn to program, that is in elementary school, they can do a lot of things, like unplugged activities. And for instance, they can already learn what a formal language is by building their own formal language to describe dense steps. So very simple dense steps. You tell them, go north, go east, go west, and go south. And they can already write a sequence of these kind of instructions. But there are also other languages where you can describe the same motion, like Logo, where you don't have north, south, east, west, but you have forward and turn around yourself. And you can even translate a program from one language to another. In both directions, it's not that easy, especially for pupils. They can understand, for instance, what a pixeled image is. So if you have looked at the book 1, 2, 3 Codé of La Main à la Pâte, they have a very good activity where you take a hat and you have a 4x4 grid, and then you color each square or not. So it's very pixelized. But in the end, you recognize the hat, and you can make the difference between two hats. So they can also discover how to use some programs, like sending a mail and using a web page and using a text processor. And, of course, we don't think they should know how to use a text processing system, but using a text processing system is a very good way to ask yourself many questions. How is each letter represented, and how does the error correcting system works, and so on. And they, as I said, they can also learn how algorithms are everywhere in math, in cooking, in space, orientation in space, and so on. In middle school, they learn how to program, and after middle school, in high school, they can learn informatics as we know it, so they can understand how to compile a program, how to, so this is what they can do in about languages. Now they can design their own programming languages and compile them. Maybe not very complex programming languages, but they can start with, for instance, the language they use in primary school with north, east, east, west, or a kind of logo-like language. Then they can compile it or interpret it in high school. And they can learn cryptology, complexity, machine architecture, and so on. And this is basically the informatics we teach in university now, and we should teach in high school to give us more time in a university to teach in more interesting things. Okay, so this was my cooking recipe in four lines. To build a curriculum, we have to keep a balance between the four concepts of informatics. We have to keep a balance between science and technology. We have to keep a balance between the core of the subject and its interfaces, both with other subjects taught in school and with society questions. And we have to learn informatics in three steps, kindergarten and elementary school, then middle school programming, then high school informatics as we know it today in universities. Thank you.
So, is there any question for Gilles? Yeah. We have another microphone there, I think.
Thanks. Hello. I'm curious about the material that resulted from this organization in France. Is it available in any language other than French, which probably would be easier for us to translate?
I don't think so. So there are several books in French, but French and Spanish are very close, and the books are not written in very complex French. So. You can guess with a good dictionary. Okay, so a few words about the material. You remember it started with informatics in the last year of high school. So for that, we wrote a textbook, which only exists in French, but you have it in Java or in Python, so it's possible to translate, but we have translated the program, not the French part. Yeah, if you want to translate it to Spanish, you're welcome. Then for the elementary school, there is this initiative which has been taken by La Main à la Pâte that materialized by the book 1, 2, 3 Codé. And this book was a huge success. La Main à la Pâte has this policy that when they write a book, they send it for free to the teachers who ask for it. Okay, if you're not a teacher, you cannot ask for it. You have to buy your copy. And it's sold in bookshops, and it's online or in real bookshops, physical bookshops. And they also have this policy to find a sponsor so that they can send the book for free to the teachers. So I think they thought what they had printed was 10,000 copies or something like this, and they thought it would last 6 months, and it lasted 3 days. So just after they released the news that there was this book, in 3 days they gave away, so they didn't sell, they gave away then 10 1,000 copies. So it was a huge success, and the book is very good indeed. So this is another piece of material that I don't think it has been translated neither to English nor to Spanish nor to German or Finnish. And now La Main à la Pâte is working on another book for middle school. So it's not finished. So it's not released, it's not translated. Yeah, but just a word on textbook, it's very important. Because for the teachers, they are completely lost and they need guidelines. And a book with the material to teach and the exercises and the examples and so on is much more useful for them than the official curriculum that is put online by the Ministry of Education. And it is our duty as computer scientists to translate the curriculum into a book, to translate the 2-page curriculum into a 300-page book. Usually the students don't use the book, but the teachers do. But the book should be written for the students, but then you see that empirically the teachers read the book, not the students.
Any other question?
Hello. You said many times that the curricula your opinion is that very good, no? So how sure can you be that it will work at school?
Okay, I don't know this, and we have to try. And probably in 5 years, we will write another curriculum because we understand that some topic we loved didn't work, and some topic we put by chance worked very well. So we have not yet enough experience about this, except for, as I said, the last level of high school, where we have been teaching that for 4 years. So we already know what the students like, what the teachers like or not. And this is why we have been working on a second version of the curriculum, which has some modifications with respect to the first. I didn't claim that the curriculum was perfect. What I claimed is that the curriculum was there, and that if you look at it, it sounds reasonable. And it's a very important point when we compare it to the teachers that we don't have, and when we address this issue, we still hear that anyone can teach informatics in school and that there is nothing special about informatics and you don't need to be trained in university to teach informatics in school. So the situation is very different. On the curriculum, on the question of curricula, we have a kind of good interaction with this higher committee for curricula, and maybe we are doing some mistakes, but we will be able to correct them. On the question of hiring teachers, we are completely on the wrong track, and this is an important difference between curricula and teachers.
I found very interesting your discussion about the balance between science and technology, and also to learn and to do. I think that it's a huge challenge to properly transfer to the school. So regarding this, another challenge is, I think, how difficult it is to teach the teachers about it, and mainly considering that you are teaching them with online courses. I understand that you cannot do a 17 teachers course many times. It's so difficult to reach 300,000 teachers. So. How are you planning to face this challenge?
Okay, so it's a very difficult challenge because what you can change in a teacher is the content of what she or he is teaching. Okay, so you take a history teacher, she has been teaching ancient history, now she has to teach modern history. Okay. It may take time for her to learn more about modern history, but basically it will work. But what you cannot change is the method of teaching. And if you take math teachers, they have a very good method for teaching math, which is to do a course on the blackboard and to give exercises and to correct exercises and so on. So for them, it's very not the content is not that difficult to learn, but changing the method of teaching is very difficult for them because they are not used to that. Okay. For instance, math teachers are very reluctant to use robots. Okay, it's not more difficult to use a robot than to use a program, but they are afraid of material objects. I mean, material objects are not part of their of the way they think. So when you give them a robot, they are afraid the robot is not going to work, or the battery will be down, or the robot will fall from the table, or I don't know. Okay, so it's much more difficult for them to teach robotics, although the concepts are not much more difficult than in other areas. But they are not used to this kind of pedagogy. And they are not used to, exactly in the same way, they are not used to have a class where everyone is working on a different project, and they go from one student to the next, which is what we do every day. And we ask them, oh, what are you doing? Where are you? What is this variable about? And is it working? And if not, why not? And you should try to test your program earlier or later or whatever. This is not the way they teach. They go, they see the exercise, they correct it, and this is the way math is taught. So this is very difficult to change the habits of the teachers and even the position of the teacher in the classroom. Okay. To sit with a student in front of a computer, we think it's very normal, but for them, the teacher has to be sitting on the chair and talking to the audience. So they are not used to sit and to search with a student. Okay, so the high school teacher I had in my training program, they asked me, what if I sit with a student and we are looking for a mistake in the program and we don't find it? I said, okay, you say you don't find it, what can you do? Well, you try harder. Sometimes the students can be very perverse in having writing code that doesn't work. I mean, they are very good at this, and from time to time it takes us hours to find the mistakes in their program, but it's not a problem for us. It's a problem for them because it's not the way they interact with students. Mm-hmm. This, I don't think we are going to change it. The only way we can change this is to hire new professors that have been trained in this way themselves and for whom what is a failure and what is a success is something completely different. And for that, I don't think we are going to take 50-year-old math teachers and teach them a completely new way of teaching. It will not work. We have to hire other teachers.
Regarding teachers training, I was wondering how many hours you devote to teachers training. And also, when you think about teachers training, there's usually two ways about it. One has to do with traditional professional training where you go through theoretical concepts and you build a strong foundation into a subject and thinking that what he will have to teach will be a byproduct of what you initially taught him. The other way around it is, okay, this is the course you will have to teach, learn it by heart, repeat it. What's your way about it?
Okay, so my view is that we should teach the teachers in the first way, and their view is that they should be taught in the second. So when we have these training sessions, at the end, we have an evaluation form, and the criticism that comes more often is that what they have learned, they cannot use in class. Okay, so you teach them RSA, they are teaching in sixth grade, so they cannot teach RSA in sixth grade, it was useless. Okay, so we try to explain to them that if they want to teach César encryption, it's better if they know other encryption schemes, but they are so under pressure that they want to have something they can use very, very quickly. So we have to take this into account because we cannot teach them something they don't want to learn. As teachers, we know it never works. But even if we give them exercises that they can do with their pupils, it's good that we give them a few hints about something deeper, something more complex. Because first, they have to be able to build exercises by themselves. So if we give them 10 exercises, they should be able to imagine an 11th one and not just repeat the 10 exercises they have learned with us for forever. And also, they have to be able to answer the questions the students will ask. And if they have learned the course by heart, it's much more difficult to answer the questions. So this is the limit of lifelong learning. And if you take 5 years to make a teacher, to teach a teacher, you have time to give them knowledge and in the first year and the second year, and then in the end of the courses of their learning program to discuss how to teach and what to teach and so on. But when you have a 1 week session, you have to be very down to earth. So you don't have time to do better. On your first question, it's difficult to tell, and I am very inconsistent in this matter. The training is organized locally in France. Everything is centralized in France, but not this. So every region is organizing the training of their teachers. And it depends on the region. So in the suburbs of Paris where I teach, this region is very rich and they have a lot of money, not a lot of money, but they have a decent amount of money to train teachers. So for teachers who teach in high school, we were able to organize a weekly program. So they came every week for a full day. So it was in the end 30 days, so something like 300 hours. And they had to do projects from 1 year to the next, from 1 week to the next week, and so on. In other places, they gave them a 3 hour training. In other places, there were no training at all. So they became informatics teacher just by magic. They went to bed on Sunday night, and on Monday morning, they were informatics teacher. Okay, so we don't know what happened. It's very difficult to learn something in 3 hours. For instance, imagine you have to teach Japanese. Okay, so if you spend 1 hour on vocabulary, 1 hour on grammar, and maybe 1 hour on literature, it's very difficult to teach Japanese after that. And even after 1 week, if you learn vocabulary on Monday and grammar on Tuesday, well, it's very difficult then to teach Japanese to students, especially if you have students who have already taken 2 years of Japanese, for instance. Okay. So at the beginning, I didn't want to participate to any kind of training that would be less than 1 year. And then it is a kind of inconsistency that you have to face when you are doing things. Eventually, I organized myself a training session that was 1 week, 1 full week, okay, so it was maybe 30 hours or 40 hours for middle school teachers. And if we don't do that, they will have nothing, okay, so there are two different agendas. One is to convince the policymakers to hire informatics students in school. One is to do with what we have, and the forces I had at that time were enough to organize a 1 week training, but not more. Okay, so I did it. Maybe I should not have, but I decided to do it anyway.
Hi, Ed. Really nice what you everything you have explained here. I really believe in that's the North. Related teaching, but correct me if I'm wrong, but I haven't understand that we are here stuck in a dichotomy or at least a tension between two ways of refactoring the system. One way is to refactor the mind of the teachers, the current teachers, and the other if to replace them by new minds, by new teachers. Mm-hmm. I think that's the dichotomy or the problem you have. You have here and here in Argentina it happens too, and I think, or I understand that presumes that assumes you have only one teacher in the course, and why we're thinking in trying to refactor the mind of the current teacher that okay, it's outdated, it's very difficult to update him or her, but at least he or she has the mind, she knows how to deal with the problems of the students, and complementing him or her with teachers, informatic teachers, or not necessarily informatic teachers, but teachers that have better understanding of informatics. Why not try, instead of spending time and money in refactoring the minds or replacing them, and instead complementing them, the new minds with the better didactic and better understanding of the informatics subject, and the field experience of the existing teachers.
Okay, first of all, I don't want to replace the teachers, but the teachers replace by themselves. I mean, every year 2% of the teachers go on retirement, and we hire more teachers. So this is, of course, a very powerful way to change the system. It's a very slow way to change the system, but it's a very powerful way to change the system. We don't have to hire teachers that are exactly as those who leave the system. And this natural replacement of teachers by other teachers should be a way for us to change the system. And we should not neglect it. So I don't want to fire the teachers and to replace them by better teachers or by teachers of different topics. I just think this organization over time is something we should be aware of. Okay, then you can, what you propose is to complement what the teacher already know with more knowledge so that they teach better. And this is what we are doing actually with lifelong learning. So we have teachers who already teach and they know the student and they know a subject, and we are teaching them another subject so they can teach it to the students. I think, as I said, I think it doesn't work. We have to do it, but it has to be a transitory solution. It works a little bit, but it cannot work on the long time, because teaching is something difficult for which you need yourself to be trained. You wouldn't consider that being a medical doctor, being an engineer, being a lawyer is something you can learn just by doing it. Okay, so you respect these kind of professions and you think it's normal or it's natural that to become a physician you go to school, you go to for 7 years, and to become an engineer you go to school for 6 years, and to become a lawyer you have to go to law school for 6 years as well. Okay, so this is something we understand. I think we should respect the teachers exactly in the same way. Teaching a new subject is something difficult, and it's not something we should ask to the teachers. Then, of course, there are teachers that are awesome, and they can do it. And also, as you said, having teachers working in teams and teachers working in pairs is also a way for them to learn more. But we should not expect that our teachers can learn 10 different subjects and be efficient in 10 different subjects, and especially if it is taught for 3 hours. I mean, it will not work. And we know it, so we have to find another solution.
Okay. One last question.
Hello, I apologize for my English. Thank you very much for your talk, very interesting. I will refer also to the training of teachers, an expression that I don't like, because I think that there are an expression that for that discipline of informatics that is didactic of informatics. In the English world, they call computer science education. Yep. There are a lot of investigation about that, etc., etc. So my question is,
Estoy hablando mal. Ah, perdón. My question is, besides all these ways to put teachers to teach, don't you think that it will be necessary to have, for instance, a structured and sustainable didactic of informatics, because it needs investigations, not just to teach. It's not to do, as you said, for the curriculum, for the didactic of informatics is the same. Well, I don't know if you understand my question.
I understand it very well. First, I have to apologize for my English as well. So, when we have teachers for 1 week, we decided to teach them mostly informatics and not informatics education. And informatics education is an underdeveloped topic compared to physics education or didactics of mathematics and so on. For a very simple reason is that we have been teaching mathematics for 2,000 years. So we had time to develop theories and to do experiments and to understand what works and what doesn't work. And informatics has been taught in some countries, but not that much. So we don't have enough material yet to have real, yeah, of course. But in the future, of course, and we already see it, as soon as new experiments are organized, created, and in schools, then we see that our colleagues who are interested in didactics of sciences, for instance, start investigating what works and what doesn't work in informatics. And of course, the knowledge we all have, because we have been teaching and we have been learning in teaching, we should, in a way, reconsider it on the light of the work of these researchers. I will give you a very simple example. We have a game which is called the Hanoi Tower. I don't know if you heard about this game. Okay. And when I teach recursivity, it is my example number one. And one day I ask myself, how come did I choose this exercise to teach recursivity? And then I understood the only reason why I chose this exercise is because when I was myself a student and I was taught recursivity, this was the example that has been used. Well, in this case, this example works very well, but probably there are much better exercises we can do to learn what recursivity is, and currently we don't know them, so we still use the Hanoi Tower game, but in 200 years, maybe they will have understood that there are other problems, other programs that are much better. And we need to learn for them, but of course, we need also to provide them the data so that they can build their theories, and currently we are starting to have data, but we don't have enough data so that this process completely works.